You can see outside, it's something we've waited for a long time, a bright sunny day. And we have Gerald Champs, brand new, never been run. Sato 80. This is an 80. And we're gonna, Mike's getting the table out. We're gonna get ready to break this in today. Got a table out there?
Here it comes. It's here.
Spring is in the air and Kajewski's ready to break motors in. Now Champ, I hope you're paying attention. We're gonna get this motor run for you. And when you get it back, it'll be ready to put right into your killer plane. I think he's got two of them. We'll get this all tuned up for you.
Put the tack right behind the prop, Mike. Make sure it's on two blades. Okay.
What's the ring? Fine.
You know, if we knew it was going to be this good of a day, we would have went flying to hell with Gerald Champs. It really turned out to be a nice day.
Les Demets here, Peabody, Kajewski, they're all loving this engine, boy. Everybody wants to run home and put it in their plane.
Look at these alcoholics over here.
That is one smooth running engine, baby.
All we did, we put a piece of tubing just to see how much oil is coming. Obviously, there's oil coming out of that breather. So now the engine is oiling very well. It just keeps it a little bit neater. And we put the little rubber stinger on so that the neighbors wouldn't go crazy here. They don't even know these things are running back here. Ridiculous. Not like when we broke these strokes in.
And we'll give it the mandatory two. Actually, it's almost a gallon. That's a, I think a quart, I'm not sure. We'll give it two tankfuls of fuel at various RPMs. I'll get the needle valve set and the carburetor set, and Gerald, eat your heart out. It runs like a watch, like a Rolex watch. Now, next motor today is gonna be Mike 72, and we're gonna, basically, we just got done with the 80. That's ready to go. That's ready to put in a plane. We want to do the 72 also. We are going to get both of these broken in today. It's just an outstanding day. It's just an unbelievable day. We could have been flying. I could have been somebody. As you probably can figure out, we got a million projects going on in the shop. Every day, people coming over now. We're getting into the spring season where we have visitors every day, and I'm expecting Bob Zambelli up here with well, we don't know yet. He's got some cool stuff he's going to share with us when he gets here.
Yeah, the piped jet, I think.
Okay, Elliot Scott, now we want to have the big apology. Okay, you want to say anything to Elliot Scott?
Oh, the
it looks nice. It looks better than Elliot's, in fact. But here's the main thing. Look, where's the pizza pie? You guys come over here. You got to understand. We got to pay with a pizza pie. Come on, let's eat. Bobby, get some soda out of the fridge. Who needs Elliot Scott when we have our own pizza?
Where's the fridge?
So look, he ate the whole pizza. Stevie ate the whole pizza. All right, tell me about the plane. Come on. It has no clear on it yet. All you need is clear. Weighs 40 ounces. This is from Elliot Scott's plans. This plans
Elliot
he sent
Scott's
you?
Plans. This is Elliot Scott's
okay.
Plans.
And the foam came from the fellow.
And this is what? You had these cut out of the Mylar? Or did you cut them out yourself?
I had Mary Knight cut those out for me.
Mary cut them, okay.
She has that machine? She has that machine thing that makes
okay.
This. So I asked her to make this. Now, the reason the way I got the evolution on this was when I got the plans from Elliot on the bottom. He calls this the evolution.
Yeah, cardinal writes, evolution.
And he writes on the bottom. So this is a
that's his idea. Right over there on my bench. That's Elliot's cardinal
that's
right
Elliot's.
There.
Okay. And I had asked him, you know, when I had looked, well, actually when I saw this on the plans, I says, I want to put this on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought of a design like this. Asked Mary Knight if she could make something.
Oh, so
like
you got Mary's name up on the front.
On
that's
the machine
good.
Also. Yeah. I thought I had to respect anybody that helped contribute to any
where's your father's name?
Right there. Special thanks to Ruben.
Boy, here, how does Reuben get top billing? Man, you raised him right. Oh, my son, my name is not even on the contract.
Yeah, actually, it's a Mac machine.
Now, that looks pretty good. Now, see each...
And that's how I got the Evolution, and I asked Mary to make that all up for us.
Each one that you make is getting better now. The next one should really be nice. Should really be like Pajeski stuff.
I didn't want to go too nuts with the color. I wanted something basic.
Yeah.
I want a good flying airplane.
And where are these control systems in this plane? Or 1-8 horns.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you have heavy controls. That's good.
Heavy controls. Any belt crank, the whole 9 yards.
In. Make sure you get all that paint out of the hinges. See how much paint you got in there?
Yeah,
Scrape it up. You make an X-Acto blade with a little kerf so you can just go right down there. That really looks good.
I don't care
what Zambelli says about you.
I ain't worried about that either.
He's going to deep six the Cardinal. Put the Cardinal out in the back room and let's see this take apart nose construction.
I don't want to mess
flying tail. Got some pretty exotic stuff coming into the shop. By the way, Bobby's making up the reason his visit is here, making up some custom Sato mufflers that we're going to test, using up some of the tubing we had from our Toon pipe development. We've been hashing that idea out, and that's coming. But we want to see the twin.
This is a replica of my own aircraft. I built it for a Sato 30.
The one you took Elliot for a ride in?
That's the one.
Oh, that yellow one, yeah.
And the unique thing about this is I built the entire wing lead edge separately.
Okay.
In other words, I cut the ribs apart. There's a very hard balsa carbon reinforced spar, and I cut the ribs in half, glued the ribs on, formed the lead edge. And if you notice...
It's got dihedral?
Oh, yeah. It's a multiple taper wing. It's
got right. Okay, like a Mustang.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Taper number 1, 2, 3... And it also tapers in thickness.
Wow, hold it up so we can see the... Oh, yeah.
There's your dihedral.
Yeah,
cool. It'll carry the same tricycle landing gear as...
Three little wheel pants. Your plane has wheel pants, doesn't it?
The whole thing.
You ought to make a little Elliot in a cockpit. You know, some guy eating a slice of pizza. Well, he's not here. We can rage on him.
Now,
that'd be great.
This is... I molded this out of epoxy and fiberglass.
All right.
Simple. I made a foam plug for it. And then molded, what I did is I cross-cut the plug to make it 1/32 smaller on each side, then laid the fiberglass over that.
Ken Clapson is in the middle of making up these for the Pond Racer.
Oh, wow.
Tonight they're drying. Oh, they're out in the oven drying. He emailed me. Pond Racer out of a Cardinal.
Now, this is the unique thing about this. I wanted it to be as realistic and close to the real aircraft as possible. So what I did is I have a carbon fiber rod floating in two ball bearings, and I machined up my own control horn for it. And then...
Now what happens to these? They just get glued on, or...?
No. There's a bolt
that
goes to the bottom.
Okay, they key on.
I haven't drilled...
Man, everybody loved that other take-apart plane you had, that one with the... Well, you take one bolt out and the pilot's head comes off
exactly.
And everything?
Yeah, you like that, huh? See, this will be... It'll locate together like so.
Oh, cool. Yeah, that's nice.
And then, here's your...
All right. Tail. No flaps? Or the flaps aren't
no
connected?
No flaps on this one.
No flaps.
I'm experimenting for it. This is really just a sport fun
thing. Yeah, yeah.
And as I say, once I get it done, I'm going to have the antennas on it. It'll be just like my own aircraft.
And then you'll have Elliot in the cockpit learning how to fly.
You know,
poor Elliot. He's taking a beating tonight.
Yeah. Oops, well, won't balance there. And the everything here is built up. These are all built up. This is built up too.
I can see that.
And
yeah.
I've got where you attach it to take the torque from the actual carbon fiber, torque rod.
Right.
A screw will go through there, and there's a thin plywood rib
that
transmits the loads out.
Oh, okay, right.
Block inside.
That acts like the leg on a horn.
Exactly.
Yeah.
In effect,
yeah.
It's a control horn.
And what kind of finish is on here? This is tissue.
Right. I cover the body with silk.
Okay.
I dyed the silk first yellow, and just with a little bit of talcum and dope and a shedding brush, unfortunately.
A shedding brush,
you
yeah.
Notice the hairy?
Yeah, I know. That's what my sink looks like when I comb my hair in the morning. I keep telling Karen, it's a paintbrush.
Well, eventually you can save up enough to make a brush.
Yeah.
And I haven't weighed it yet, but...
We can weigh it.
I really would not.
That's coward! What a wimp!
It's going to have, it'll have the Sato 30 in it, as I said.
Okay. Going to have a little four-stroke. I like the way the wing meets the body. This looks so cool.
I like that.
That really does look nice.
That's formed of 1/32. The tank will, of course, drop in here. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to use a simple fiberglass plastic.
Okay, like a
mount.
Dave Brown mount. Yeah.
Exactly. So that'll bolt on. I've got three.
And you can change to any engine anytime
you
want.
And also I can change the orientation of the engine just by making another hole in the cowl.
Sure. Or just make a whole nother cowl.
Exactly.
You got a plug for that, right?
I have the plug at home, right?
Yeah.
The tank will drop in here.
Can't get this focus. Let me see. Yeah, well, you can see
this. And this is going to have throttle control.
Absolutely. So the receiver, what a unique idea. I've heard that some guy in Jersey had that idea, too.
Yeah. I'm going to have
it'll never work, though.
I know. That's what the experts tell us. The radio will be right in here, and I found a little miniature. It's called a feather servo.
Yeah, I got to say, how many grams is it?
I don't know. It's half the size of a micro servo.
All right.
The thing is so tiny.
But there's no resistance on, like on a Sato throttle. There's
just
nothing.
Exactly.
Nothing.
Exactly.
It's just ridiculous.
So that will sit right on top of the tank.
Yeah.
And I'll just have the wires, you know, I'll drill in, have the wires coming in here. And I'll just use a very simple radio to blip the, and I'll have the radio out in the car too. I'll bring that in.
That's already
installed in another plane. And we've test flown and it does work.
Look at this, he's stealing a pizza. He's stealing pizza. Look at this. Peeps, you'll get so fat you can't fly, you'll look like me, your hair will fall out.
I'm gonna spray him. Changes.
Look at this, he's gonna eat your whole slice of pie, Ruben. You'll have to go get another pie. He ate all the pepperoni off it already. Now start at the beginning. You had an NU53 in here.
That's correct.
Which then became a... What did the NU53 become? I forget. The MAX 70.
Exactly. We went from the NU53, which flew it beautifully, but it was a little marginal, obviously, at 76 ounces.
Okay.
From the NU53, we went to the OS-70, and it was a rocket ship at 82 ounces ready to fly.
Okay, the Sato knocks about 2.5 ounces off of that.
Exactly. So, now, that's with a full tank of fuel.
And this is 72. Who's this, Banjak's engine, or is this yours?
This is Dan Banjak's engine.
That's Banjak's engine?
Yep.
Okay.
He just bought it. We ran it for about an hour, three-quarters of an hour to an hour, bolted it in a plane, and blasted off.
Okay, what we're going to do, we have other engines, one of them being that we want to see just how much work it would be to put Gerald Champ's 80 into the Red Baron, or if it's possible, and we realize this is made on the same case as the 90 now. It looks like the mounts are the same and everything.
Yeah, it looks wider, though, than this.
It looks wider, so it may not even fit in there. We don't know.
We don't know that yet.
But these are like brothers or something here.
Yeah.
Well, there's one way you're going to find out.
Let's do it.
Let me give you a clue. Get the tools. Rip it out. Do a windy. Gut the motor out.
Okay,
put the Chevy V8 in there.
First, we'll just...
Now, believe it or not, even though this motor is 1/10 of an inch wider, because we made this for a Tiger 60...
Mm-hmm.
We got the 80 in there.
You bet.
Now, I'm not so crazy about how the holes are going to line up.
Well, I'll just make new plates.
You know what? You're going to have to make new plates.
That's easy enough to do.
Yeah.
I got a set for the NU. I'll just make a set for each engine we try.
Other than that, the 80 is, for all purposes, in there. Now, what do we got over here? The 90? That means the 90 will fit right in.
You got it.
Look at this bike. He's got my 90 out on the table. The Virgin 90. Never even been around. Look at this guy.
I just want to see if...
But they all look alike, though. Don't... If you don't look at the number on them, okay, you got to put, you know...
Look at the way the spinner disc goes.
Oh, yeah, Gerald, that isn't going to fit at all. We don't like that at all. Oh, my God.
Wait a minute. We can't do it unless the...
See if it fits with the... And when you put those ultra-lightweight mufflers on there... Oh, yeah, the cowling even fits. Boy, if I only could have known back then what you were going to do to my Red Baron... I would make the new plates, though. That's a given.
Yeah, that's it. That's a piece of cake.
All right. Now, listen, I want this on video. Champ said you could fly his motor, wear it out, do it. If you crash it, no problem.
No problem.
He said, yes, no problem. My 80 needs a lot of breaking in.
Okay.
You guys got a video camera down here in Philly? Any of those bozos got a video?
I got one.
Oh, well, give me some video of this thing flying.
That's just what we're
going to
do.
Boy,
yeah, look at that. Even the cowl fits.
Ah! Oh my God, the spinner even fits.
Look at that.
That Champ is some kind of guy. Gerald,
They're
butchering your motor up here.
Yeah. See, look at that. But, we gotta, how do you spell prop clearance?
What do I care? Cut some more off the nose. It'll be lighter then.
But the further you push it back, the less prop clearance you got.
Oh, yeah. Actually, I got an idea for you. Why don't you think of something? How far back can you put it when you put the carburetor on it? Can you push it back a little bit?
Let's check it out.
You'll get rid of some of the nose weight.
You know what this engine.
I think you could do that.
I got that cowl on there, so I got to be able to get it off, right? There we go.
That's not a given. Where do you have the tank shim on this? Right where I had it?
Yeah, see?
Oh, you're way up.
Here's what I do to hold my tanks in.
I got a wedge
with a piece of dental floss on it.
Yeah.
And it just...
Okay. How big is that tank? Well, there's no problem with the tank compartment.
Four ounce tank.
I want to know if the 80 is going to run with a 4 ounce tank, though.
The 72 will just barely squeak through a pattern. But
okay.
One thing I found about the Sato's, after about 2 hours, the fuel economy really goes up.
Okay.
To give you an idea, the little 30.
Then you better run Gerald's engine a lot. Minimum 2 hours.
We'll put a 10-inch prop and lean it out.
Oh, yeah. Put a 10-6 on it. Put a tuned piper up on it and see what happens.
But see, the thing is, let's quick put that carburetor.
Oh, is the shaft size the same on the 72 and the 80?
Yeah, I just checked it, see?
Okay, so you don't even have to re-drill. Oh, I'm not going to like this at all. We're going flying Saturday. I'm excited. I need to go flying. It's been a long... Look how nice the carburetor is in this. Now, this will not fit on the 90 because it's a smaller diameter inlet tube.
Be careful not to lose that.
I'm not going to lose it, yeah.
See, what that does, that compresses the O-ring.
Yeah, it gives you a seal.
Exactly.
Right, now how about the 90? Since I squished this around, maybe I ruined the seal on it.
Let's just try first of all. No.
Once I run it, I'll know if it's...
No, you can move that. It won't hurt at all. But let's just see if the 90 will drop in because you offset the carburetor.
My 90! My 90! He puts a 90! Look at this, it goes right in. It fits right in! You dog!
1.5 horsepower.
50% more power, 1 ounce more. Even the bird is impressed with that. That would be like if you took Peeps and made him an eagle.
Yeah.
Hey, get away from the Red Baron, you bird. That is... I didn't know it would fit, but we know now it'll fit. What a guy.
What did you weigh this one at?
What a guy.
Interference here at the front.
Yeah, but it's wood interference.
Exactly, that's what I said.
That would go right in there too.
The only thing is we're going to have to cut this out because remember...
Yeah, the carburetor. Yeah, well don't put the 80 in there first. Run that a couple of weeks and then by that time we'll be ready to sacrifice some more of this. You know what you ought to do? Make me up a balsa wood plug for this cowling shape and I'll make up a bunch of carbon fiber cowlings.
Okay.
So you can put one for each engine.
That's an idea.
Just make a plug. Doesn't have to be fancy either. Because each one will have different holes and everything. Now, how many? 14-year-old plane?
Is that what this is?
And it's been abused, Bobby.
By
people other than you, too.
Well, I did a lot of work. I sealed this.
I know.
This is carbon fiber here because it's so thin. But this same cowl will work on every engine from the 50. From the Super Tiger 60 up to and including the 90.
All right, so the next engine is going to be the 80. Is that the deal?
Whatever you want.
Okay, do the 80 next, and then we'll do... By that time, I'll have that laser ready to go.
Now, this is the 80, and there's no time on it, right?
No, the 80's got an hour. It's all totally broken in and everything.
You know what I'm thinking, too? All I have to do is flip the carburetor around.
See if the 72 carburetor fits on there.
Yeah, you notice it's a little bit...
It might be a lighter,
closer to the mounts on this one. But I flip this carburetor around.
You can flip them, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, this has a choke on it, too. Look, this has a choke plate. I could do if I want to use it, just easily hook a piece of wire to it. So it pulls. By the way,
you don't need a choke.
There's an advantage of the four strokes.
Let me show that on the camera. Some people have never seen how this works. You put a little wire on there, and it chokes, and of course it leaves it, that there's a bleed valve. But since on our planes there's a way of just dropping a few drops of fuel in there.
You know what I've been doing? I just with my syringe, I just hook it to the fuel filler, give it a little squeeze, it forces some fuel in. The advantage of a four-stroke engine, it's better inverted than upright for starting. Because remember the valves are in the head. So if it floods, all you do is turn a prop over backwards, the excess fuel pours right out the exhaust port. If it's upright, you can't clear the flood out. because a slug of fuel sits on top of the piston when it
right, it hydrostatically
down.
Locks.
It will hydrolock and you'll bend something.
Yeah.
When it's upside down, what you have to remember, if it floods, just gently turn a prop over backwards. And then the exhaust valve will open on a downstroke. It'll push the it'll push the fuel right out. We learned that in race cars the hard way.
Hmm.
Whenever
we haven't damaged anything yet.
No, but give us time.
Give Bandrock a half a summer and we'll have parts all over the cellar. All right, you going home to put Gerald's engine in the plane and fly it tomorrow and report back to me?
Well, I want to put some time on the engine first. I want to break it in. In fact, I probably want to buy it.
The name of this plane is the plane.
The plane.
As if there weren't enough crazy things happening in the shop here. Rather than having a Z-tron, he's got a lightweight.
What I did is
I don't even know how to describe this.
I bought a toy radio control car from Heartland of America called Little Prowler. It's got a two-channel radio in it. So what I did is I took out took the radio out, threw the Prowler away. I gutted a servo, put a little tiny 6-volt battery in there. And see, I can index it.
Let me see the thing. You have the index on it?
Oh no, you blip it to the position you want. See?
Okay. So, but you could control it in flight is the whole deal.
Oh, that's it. Yeah, I just hold it. I fly left-handed.
What a unique! This guy's got the same ideas I have. What a guy!
I just hold this in my hand, and I blip the throttle up. You can get this thing flying so low, you can fly it inverted with the tail almost dragging on the ground. It's almost stalled.
You better not tell Gerald Shamp. He'll want a throttle control in his plane.
Let's do it.
Don't tell anybody. Let's keep this a secret until we can win the Nats.
Well, what we're going to do is we're going to show up at the profile meet, but we're not telling anybody because I'm going to seal us up.
Oh, yeah. Don't say a word.
The State Circle Burners event the profile event.
Yeah.
I'm going to seal all this up, and what we're going to do is just make a little belt clamp for this. So it'll just sit on your belt, go out to the center of the circle.
What's he doing to my soda now? Hey! He just drank my Coke. Yeah, if you put a piece of monocoat over that, and don't tell anybody.
Exactly, and I'll just have, these little...
Oh, you got a Velcro.
Oh, yeah.
That's
just
cool,
remember,
yeah.
It's experimental now, so...
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
And see this little 6-volt battery here?
I may have to find a lightweight 6-volt battery for the Typhoon.
That's what that is.
Where'd you get that?
A 6-volt Walmart. It's a Walmart.
Not rechargeable, though.
No, it's a regular...
How much are the batteries?
This battery's about $3, $2 or $3.
Oh, I can't afford that. Come on, shit with the program.
I have made so many flights with this already.
I know, I haven't killed the battery in a Z-tron yet.
Look at this one, look how small that battery
is.
It's an Energizer, and it's a photo battery, and you've got to remember...
$3.
They put those in those cameras that drives the motor.
Right,
drive,
right,
focus,
right.
The whole ball of wax.
$3, and how much, take it out, can we weigh it?
Sure.
Let me see how much it weighs.
My sophisticated...
It's less than an ounce, I'm sure of that. Shows you what I know. 9 grams for one, two would be 18, half an ounce, a little more than a half an ounce.
Yeah. How can you lose?
You could definitely use that for tip weight.
Oh, yeah.
If definitely. You want to be Mr. Pro Stunt here.
Yeah. But that's all there is to
it. There's nothing, this is going to be the most exciting flying season. I'll probably have a heart attack halfway through the season. Again, thanks to Bob for sharing his ideas, and we're going to be flying with him soon. But today, we have a couple hours here. I don't really have enough time to start a major project, but I wanted to mix the paint up for the plane. Now, British Warbirds, boy, there are just unlimited choices of paint jobs. And since this is not a scale model, we're not trying to copy any one particular model, but I've always liked the very special color of blue that some of the paint schemes use. It's kind of an aqua, a light aqua. I'm going to kind of mix that color myself. An example, I don't think the white bottoms, they're really light gray I don't know how to describe that color. They're not really white. But I don't think this shows up in the air as well as the light blue. The light blue, I think, with the combination of the evasion stripes and the roundels, just sets the plane off a little bit better. And that's what I'm trying to accomplish. Never really cared for the dark brown and dark green from the early Warbirds because I don't think it shows up well in the air. And the early ones were black underneath, I guess so they could be night fighters. Just not sure that would show up the way I want it to in a stunt ship. I'm looking for bright, relatively light colors. Remember, each one of our Spitfires is just a little bit different in color and in the way the camo is done. And this one is going to be just a little bit different, but each one is kind of an, you know, some people might think, well, all the British planes were painted the same. No way on earth. They're almost no two the same. Even the Mitchells that had the light blue bottom. I always liked the way the light blue and the invasion stripes work together. So I'm going to, using this book, go over to my paint supply and try to mix that color up. I'll at least get to do a little test, and then I can think about it tonight. And if we were doing a scale model, we'd have to pretty much copy this, but it's not a scale model. We can improvise a little bit. It's a fantasy model. As the weather warms up here, the phone starts ringing off the hook. Anyway, this is, I just wanted to roughly show you how scientific this is. This is the original Brodak Sky Blue. And I'd say we're roughly half sky blue and half white, both decanted, of course. And that's come up with a color that's just about, I'm not really sure you can see, and well, you can see on the dipstick here. I'm working on a car here with a dipstick. But what I'm going to do, because we have a nice hour or two to paint out there, what I really want to do is, I'm going to, since the plane is a takeoff, I can paint the elevators and see if I'm going to be happy with this color. And then if I have some time later, after the mail is done, I'm going to try to mix up the camo colors the same way. But it's always best, if you don't have a take-apart plane, paint a light bulb, you know, paint something, a can, a jar is fine. Just to get an idea, a lot of colors get darker when they dry, lighter, and you don't know if you're really going to like them until you actually paint the plane that way. So we're going to do this, and of course you can always go back and just either lighten it up or darken it up. This will be our, what I hope is going to be the bottom color here. Yeah, it looks really a lot like some of the British warbirds. I like that color. Now, I always believe in marking up the jars, because years from now I'll forget. And another thing, always make plenty of paint. See, people make just enough to paint the plane, then they need to touch something up, and then a new color they mix doesn't match. You know, be a big spender. It doesn't cost that much more, mix enough to do two planes. Years from now, if you really like the color, use it, or you can always add some blue to it, you can add some white. You have infinite variability. Shelf life is very good on Brodak Dope, by the way. Sir, it's Anaheim, and I'm going to try to find a little part here to test this color out on. Like I said, I'm going to put paint in the gun. Why does everything have to be so difficult? And what that usually means is, right up in the nozzle of the gun, from the last time I painted it, it's got a little booger of stuff, and we need to clean that with thinner. Little nozzle, whether it's Will Nemora's gun or a Campbell gun, there's two little tiny holes. So if you just rattle this around in a jar of thinner for a few minutes, you notice that'll troubleshoot that problem right away. Leave this, the end of the gun, in a can of clean thinner. That'll work. Or you can just do what I do. See, I never take the paint out of the gun. The paint, the gun does never sit with no paint in it. It never sits there. But every once in a while, a tip will get clogged up either way. So, and over the years, you save money on thinner. That's what the bottom line is. Now I want to get the part. And I want to do a little test here. I want to paint the bottom. Notice I'm doing a part that it won't matter if it doesn't come out the color I want, because I can just sand it down and put another coat of paint on it. What I'm trying to do is see if I'm going to like the color. And while this is drying, I'll mix up the gray and the green. Get some idea if I'm going to like this color. I want to do that, I want to make that decision in bright sunlight, not in shade, not in fluorescent light. I want it out in the sun. Okay, this is going to be a bright color, I like this. And it's going to be just dark enough to accent the invasion stripes. Coverage looks good thanks to a little bit of a decant job there. I want to see that the paint is laying down good, so I know I have a pretty close to the amount of thinner I need. Then I can put that aside to dry. Now, the thing I wanted to do, I wanted to just rough in the blue, and when I do the camouflage, of course, I'm going to have to put the whole plane together. But this is parts that I think I can just rough in. And again, there's not a fine edge there. There's a blend edge. And it took me a while to get that the color I wanted with the blue. But once you have it, I've probably got enough to make three models with. Now this, because we're going to see inside of this, I want to do inside too. You know, I have this set a little bit too, it's down too far. It's not fanned out enough. I want to do inside. But we're going to see some of that. And when we look in here, we're going to see some. Actually, I ought to paint the whole inside of the cowl in blue. I want to leave that little feather edge along it. Now, this is one of the areas you do a little bit of it, you get a little bit of a gain on. In the fact that it's a take-apart plane, it's a little bit easier to do it this way. Now I'll have to mask the bottom when I do the top. That'll be one of the downsides, because I need to make a straight hinge line cut. I don't want to have a faded cut. So I'll make a straight line around the whole perimeter, to maybe around the whole part, I don't know. And I want to go about halfway up the leading edge if I can. Now the second half, I want to hold it. I want to go halfway down that hinge line. Actually, I can go all the way and then just tape it. Again, I'm spraying 20 pounds of pressure, decanted paint. About 60% thinner, a little more than half thinner. Again, I'm going right up to the middle of the hinge line, but not over it. Trying to get a, let me see from this side, if we can get the sun to reflect on this. So we can see if we've missed now. Now the next thing we're going to do is, and pretty much I'm not going to even bother putting this on video, is back masking the roundels, the yellow, and the invasion stripes, both sides. And I can probably get this one faster. See, some jobs take longer than you think they will, some go faster, this one went faster. But I may be able to get all the blue on today, and then tomorrow, well, you never know. Miracles do happen. Okay, everything is back masked here. The only trouble is it's really getting cold out there. All of a sudden, they promised us a couple of nice warm days. And the last thing I still need to do is get the coat of clear along the edge of the last couple of pieces and get out there and get ready to paint, because it's getting colder by the minute. It's actually getting darker by the minute.
About it, it's getting cold out here.
Anyway, one of the things I know you'll see is that I marked which side is the blue side. So for obvious reasons. I have painted the wrong side. Anyway, the way the sun is here, I'm just not catching the sun the way I want. I want it to catch the sun. It looks like, even though we worked on this most of the day, this turned out to be a quiet day in the shop. I shouldn't say that. There's no such thing as a quiet day. There's only a busier day. Busy and busier. This time of the day, when everything's in the shadow, you can get a good candle on the parts you're painting. What I'm trying to do is, with very low pressure, get on two or three really light coats rather than blow on a thick, heavy coat. Because this is the part where, in the model, where I'm trying this. There's no double paint on here, just the black and white, the black on top of the white. But to keep that, even though this might look like a lot of paint is going on, this is really an ultra-thin coat. It looks like we're just gonna luck out at the bottom of the ninth here with this sun and with the way the day has turned out. Get an idea of, look at the sun. You can see the sun, right, reflecting in it. Be a little more difficult to paint. See, the problem is I don't really have a way of holding it. Well, I'm gonna have to sacrifice the middle of this. I'm not sure. A lot of times holding it is the biggest job of all. I guess I'll do the middle last. See, I'm trying to use the sun. Now, the most difficult part of this whole thing is getting the blend from where the bottom blue meets up to the top camo. That edge or line, especially on the hinge lines, that's kind of a critical thing. I'm real happy with the color, the way it worked out. As soon as you go to paint the gun, the wind comes up. Oh man, it was calm out here before. Anyway, this is just an example we're trying to get before nightfall. Get everything painted. It'll be a miracle if we do, but that's okay too. I'm giving everything two light coats. I know that's hard to define, but what it is, when I think it's covered and I wait, the second coat I'll add just a little more thinner to the mixture. Notice I have the tip weight box in place. If you paint it separate, a lot of times it just comes out a slightly different shade. Now what I'm going to do is let this dry and then try to do the center as a separate thing once this is dry. It's just that otherwise there'd be no place to hold it. There's no place left to hold it. The difficult part here is to get the line, because of course tomorrow or the next day I'll have to put the whole plane together to get those lines to line up the way I want them to. Now I really want to have this line up underneath because this is going to be blue. And it's one of the fudge factors we have to deal with. But the light blue will help accent the maneuvers a little bit better than the camo anyway, so probably a good trade-off. Been quite a temperature change today, but looks like we're going to get through it without a major remix of the paint. Now I need to figure out again. This is the fudge factor. This is going to come in right about here. Not exactly scale, but then it really can't be. Once we put it all together, then we'll see where we want to make the adjustments. Now I got to get, this is going to be a pain too. I got to get, luckily, right up here. Long now before we'll be pulling the pond apart, getting it set up for the summer. And it'll all be drying up tonight up by the heating vent. And tomorrow we'll put it together and lay out the camo. Now it looks like everything has dried up as well as we could have expected. The next step on this is going to be to put the gray on. And I want to mix that color, or at least make a decision that I'm going to use it exactly as I have it. For something like that, which is probably pretty close to polar gray, maybe a little bit lighter. Now it's a little tricky when you come to figure this out. If you were going to paint the green first, or if you're going to paint the gray first, then that's a decision, you know, I have to make right now. I think it's going to be easier in this case to paint the gray first, put the gray, and just try to simulate where the stripes are going to be. Because, again, what I'm trying to do is not paint anything twice. I want to paint everything once. So I want to look around, make sure I don't have any spots on here that I originally want blue, not to be blue, so that when I go to do the gray, I can pretty much lay it out as if the green was already there, and then lay the green out in all the spots that are still silver. At this point in time, it's always good to look around, because there's always spots that just need a little extra shot of blue or a little extra shot of something. I think we're in pretty good shape here, though. This is where it gets a little tricky, because we're trying to simulate the way the camo is on the real plane, which is kind of in bars. Anyway, we're going to give this a try. In fact, like I said, we're going to add some thinner to the paint because it's cold out here. See what happens as it gets colder. I need to thin this paint out a little more. There we go. But I'm just going to simulate the random striping that normally would be. Now when I get to do the green camo, which is going to be the opposite of this, then what I'm going to try to do, and it'll be interesting to see if I can do it. Paint is still too thick. See, I'm always, boy, this gets difficult to do too. I'm always trying to paint, I got a thinner paint. Always trying to get the paint to flow as thick as possible so I'm not blowing a lot of thinner into it, but sometimes it doesn't work. Got to thin the paint. Happened because we're trying to spray the paint too thick. I don't know if you can see, well, I'm trying to adjust this down to the thinnest possible line. There we go. Because I want to eventually use this for camo edging. So I want it to be, oh man, it's colder than I thought it was actually. This is always the problem with being cold. It doesn't feel cold until you get out here, and then you could die. Okay, I'm trying not to get the paint really liquidy thin. That's the whole problem here. And I'm trying to push it further than it should be pushed. Nice thing about doing soft camo edges is it won't really matter if we miss a few spots. We can always change it. And we're just laying out a base here. It's actually the green is what we have to do to really get it accurate. So with the gray on there for now, this is going to have to dry. And this afternoon, later this afternoon, we'll put the green on. Now this has really been one of the most difficult parts of the job. You can see what my hands look like. I've been trying to match that color relatively close. And of course I have several color pictures. The flat olive drab, I've added a little bit of black to it and a little bit of green. But like everything else, to get it an exact match, I need to do a little test and then see what it looks like when it's going to dry. Now you can see this color says flat olive drab, and I sold Paul Walker some of this and he put clear over it and it got nice and clear and his plane was nice and shiny. So that's the motive here. It just needs a little change in tint to be more like the Typhoon that I'm looking at. Things I want to experiment with a little bit and see if it's going to be appropriate. This was from Will Nomura, the Iwata airbrush. Now the problem I've had with airbrushes in the past is when you paint and then put tape on top of the paint, a lot of times it'll lift because the paint goes on dry. But I'm going to do a little experiment and see if, because it is complex the way the camo edges come, and I want to have soft camo edges, but I want to have them to see if I can get just the edges airbrushed in. Then if I have to, if it doesn't want to fill in real well with the airbrush, I can fill it in with the bigger gun. Anyway, these are available from Will Nomura, and you can look him up in Pampa. If you don't have an airbrush, this is definitely, looks like the highest quality one I've ever seen. Wait, the way this airbrush works, you press the trigger down for air and back for paint. And I still haven't figured out the exact mixture of the paint, but I figured this would be a good time to try kind of work on it. Let's see, what I want to see is if the line is going to have the right feather edge that I want. Now the other question was, is this going to fill in the way I expect it to? If not, I'll have to use the bigger gun. That looks like it's filling in okay. Now there's a lot of paint jobs where you could use this, but the caution I would give everybody is really be careful if you're going to have to put tape on top of it. Yeah, we're trying not to put two coats of paint on anything. Let's get right down in the hinges. Now I can tell from the way this paint is laying out, it's a little too thick. I'm going to add a little bit of thinner to the paint. Okay, with the paint a little thinner, I'm getting a little bit better edging on it. Now what I found was I couldn't fill in with the airbrush as well as with the bigger brush. So I did a little experiment to see if I could paint the whole area, let it dry, and then just outline it with the airbrush. And that looks like it's going to be the most reasonable way to do this. Have to experiment with both guns to get the, at least I do anyway, to get this kind of faded look that I'm looking for. And I think it's going to be easier to just do it. See, I can fill in with this brush, with this airbrush, I can fill in a lot easier. The airbrush, it gets all zebra stripey, but I can get nicer edges. Let me just richen this up. And then what I have to do, once everything dries, I need to put the whole model together and see that all my paint lines line up. You know, you're not trying to replicate any particular design, but I want it to be, certainly want it to be similar. So that looks like it'll be the best of all worlds, is do the edging with the airbrush, first paint it in, and then edge it with the airbrush. And what they'll be when this is over, there'll be a lot of touching up where little spots oversprayed around a hinge line, but this will get it roughed in. Gone back and forth with this for quite a while, trying to decide whether I like the airbrush better. It's almost like they both work, but I wanted to get just that look of, and not too many stripes, and very random. Then it looks like we're close. We're gonna make some changes to this as we go along, but for this point this will be fine. And we want to put the whole plane together after we do the same thing to the body, where the body and wing connect, to make any adjustments we have to. Where I'm going to have to make the wing to fuselage joint to get that to blend in. Now see what's going to happen here, because we have a convex shape, there's an overspray, and I'm going to have to deal with that separately. There's just no way I can really spray this without getting in there. Thank you. until we get the plane put in one piece. This is about as roughed in as it gets, and I should be able to do all the touch-ups down in the cellar where I don't have to deal with, as you can see, the wind and the inconsistencies out here, but I think we're pretty close. Now, there's certain areas like right here where we have to, and I guess it'd be easier to do this with an airbrush. I can mark where these areas are from this point on, where the flaps come up, and in the back if there's any, I gotta look and see back by the rudder if there are any places. I can also go over and look at the book and see if I've gotten, you know, I'm not trying to make an exact copy of the camel, but I've got roughly the same amount of stripes and the rough percentage of thickness on each one. This is the area where an airbrush is probably a lot better than the other, because I can get right in these little areas. And then when I take it apart, I don't want to seal them. What I want to do is I want to just make sure I have that location where that's going to join, because it won't really look too cool if I miss that line. In fact, I've missed it. Now normally I wouldn't spray in a house like this, but we have the ability right now. Karen's not going to be back for a while, and I will air the house out. This will give me the marks. Now I've got a lot of overspray out on a blue, and what I thought I could do is put a little bit of blue in the airbrush, but touching up the overspray areas. This, what this does too, it adds a little bit of interest to it. In fact, I gotta get this up. And we'll get some fans going here right away. And I gotta do the same thing back in here. I have to keep that up. On doing a job like this, it's good to have both the airbrush and this little area I can fill in, but it's difficult to fill the big areas in without getting striping. Now once I take this apart, I'm going to look for all the areas that possibly, I got to get some back by the tail, possibly where I've gone out over onto the blue and got some overspray. If you can see, but the overspray, because this is in an area here that I, you know, I don't want to address right now. What I want to do is take the plane apart and just repaint the gray in this area, because I don't want the overspray. Also, see where I put the flap up? I got kind of a, let's see if you can see that, kind of like, so it's easier now. Now I know where the lines are, and now I can go in with my, with the airbrush with some gray in it and get rid of that overspray. And then the last thing is get rid of any of the overspray, and I think there was some up by the cowling. There was some right up there that I wanted to get rid of up on the nose. But basically, I think that's as good as it gets for right now. To get the hinge lines, you can see the overspray. I just laid a piece of tape, and I'm going to just with the airbrush, just dust that hinge line in. This is one step that really got time consuming. And it's the first take apart camel I've had, so I've had an infinite amount of time to get this hinge line right. Same thing with the tail, and the same thing with where all the fillets and edges come together. This really got time consuming. I was shocked how long that took. Anyway, I'm at the point where I'm probably 90% happy with this, and what I want to do now is I want to put one thin coat, just the thinnest coat of clear, one coat along all my edges, because as I go forward with this, ink the plane or whatever, and I don't want to put it over the other thing, just over the camo areas, just the camo. That'll seal this blend, because otherwise this is done partially with an airbrush, and I'm afraid it's just too vulnerable the way it is. I think what would happen is you just rub that and you're going to see the little edge there, and I'm not happy with that possibility. After all this work, I'd like it to be as nice as possible. I guess the only one we can take, I can take that off, but I don't want to take the roundels or anything. I just want to seal those camo edges. Now see how this worked out in the middle of the fuselage? Again, I'm not sure there isn't a better way to do this, but for the first take apart camo, this is, I think we've got it real close. Now the only thing I noticed, the green on this is a lot greener, and I'm not sure I like the green, that green, because the color photos of it show a much browner, darker. Virtually all of them are a lot closer to this color, which is a little darker version of the olive drab flat that Brodak manufactures. But now, one piece at a time, I want to take it outside, set the gun up with clear, and just the lightest coat I can get on there, just to seal those edges in. Sometimes when I'm putting on that coat of clear, I see some little spots because I'm out in the sun again. I'm going back and forth. I'm out in the sun again, and I want to get, just trying to clean the gun here. I saw some spots on the blue on the cowling that I wanted to touch up before I put the clear on. So once you put the clear on, then you kind of overlay, and that's defeating the whole purpose of what I want to do. There we go, it's nice and clean. But so far, I've had good luck with the airbrush, and the airbrush is really good for doing those edges, but it's just really inconvenient to try to get to lay out a whole area. It just looks like a crossword puzzle. Edge here where some of that paint just bled through. The point is, from this point in time on, oh, I gotta get the phone. It's just an endless little touch up, and I'll get that with the gray, of course. Let me get the phone. A lot of these things that I do, at this point, I'm saying to myself, and I'm sure I'm not unique in this, oh man, this is taking a lot of time. But then when the job is done, you say, oh man, was that worth it? I want to feather that edge in. And it's really, there's a little change right now in my whole approach to everything here is I have to drop it on the floor. I have to start every time I handle a part looking for little mistakes that I can correct before I get into those last coats of clear. But that once I get this dry, I'll start getting on the coats of clear. The coats of clear will seal it up, make it that I can handle it, and even if I have some paint on my hands or glue or whatever, it won't ruin the delicate finish. The only purpose of this coat of clear is just to blend the lines in. Let me richen this up. I just want to see if this is going to blend in and leave a nice edge. What's up? Yeah, I don't need to do the blue, I just need to do the edge. Now what you can see when you do this, you can see the airbrush blends look a little bit fuzzier. Let me show this. If you can see, they're a little bit fuzzier than these, where they don't really stand out. And I just need to do the airbrush areas where I've camoed. Sounds like I'm a rug merchant or something, where I've camoed. This clear is a little thick. I could even put a little more thinner in the clear. But that should seal it up. And right to dark here today. But anyway, I thinned out the clear even more.
this I only need a coat, and it's actually the thinner in the clear that makes the blend happen. And it seals the blend. Is that how many times I've gone back and forth with these edges, but I think in the end it's really gonna pay. Now see, at this point in time too, if I see an area I don't like or where I've got some overspray, typically it's overspray that's the problem, I can address it right now. And that should dry, that should seal. Let me get a candle of sun here. Added just a little more thinner to the paint, to the clear, only so it would tend to melt and blend that edge in. See how thin that's going on? That's probably about 70% thinner, but I don't want to put any more than I have to either. That's got that nice feather edge now that I like. You can see the tree reflecting in there. Now this is an area where you have three blends coming into one. Again, it gives you just that little highlight. I learned one thing, if you wet down these edges, they will blend. So even a little extra thinner in a paint. And I can still touch them up if I get an area that I'm not happy with, for whatever reason, it'll just be a question of touching it up. This is it for today, and we've toughed out another day in a, shall we just say, non-Anaheim weather. It's amazing how many times I went back and forth to see a spot that I thought I had, and I'd put a little gray, put a little camo, put a little gray. And finally you get it where you're happy with it. 10 minutes later you look at it and you see something else. I guess it's just the way this type of a project is. This part of it, labor intensive. But the airbrushing, if people appreciate it, people that know how difficult it is to get that just right, that look, not so sure we have it, but anyway, that's my rendition of camo, typhoon camo, whatever you want to call it. Tomorrow we have two projects to work on. Mike Kajewski's going to be here to work on his plane, hopefully. And we'll try to get all the tape off of this. And on an ongoing basis, right up to the very end, we'll try to fix any flaws we see, any little mistakes.
camo is just a little more difficult than painting a plain white and putting a red stripe on a leading edge, but when you get it, I think it really looks nice. And when this all dries up, can't wait to see this with the tin foil off of it. Anyway, we've taken advantage of a day that Karen's been away the whole day at a meeting, and hope she doesn't shoot me when she gets home having this dry up in the house. It is really getting cold again out there. And it's supposed to rain, so it looks like we've made a good investment. I really think that's gonna be as good as I can possibly make it, and it really does have the look of a typhoon. See you tomorrow. Got a funny story, quick story from Mexico. Just yesterday, Karen and I went to see Traffic, and I saw this. If you haven't seen the movie Traffic, it's unbelievable how depressing it is. And today I get this thing from Mexico. And so it's from a guy that a couple months ago, he ordered some videos. And I'm going to read his exact note. I just find in my mailbox videos. You sent January. Day great. Thank you. Send me more. And he sent this picture of his plane. Anyway, this is his plane down here. But I just love, look at the Al Rabe Mustang. I just love having, I'm assuming that's an Al Rabe Mexican Mustang. Can you imagine how we add Mexico to Cuba to every, I got to send this guy a stunt news. He's not a member of Pampa either. Absolutely, this is unbelievable. And now this is the part I wanted to show you. And you can't make this up. Look at what he's got for a motor. He knows we're a Sato dealer. 2 million pesos and you can have a Sato. Anyway, I just love, this is worldwide. I love it. It just doesn't get any more fun than this. Funny. Bob Zambelli, when he was here, and of course, wasn't long ago, he sent me these pictures, copies of the pictures. This guy looks like he's auditioning for the Sopranos here or something. Unbelievable. You've noticed over the course of the last week, he's got his adult feathers. Hey, Chickadoolie. He's got his adult feathers. His whole face is black now, and he's got an orange underbelly. Anyway, he wants to go to Brodax so bad. Peeps, you want to go to Brodax? You want to go to Brodax? Look at this. Who's this guy? Another criminal. You want to go to Brodax, peeps? Come on, baby. Yeah, take me to Brodax. Look at this adult. He's an adult now. All right, we got to pull that tinfoil off the plane next. Now, let's take a break from shop action here. One of the people that really, I think, is underappreciated in the whole event, and in my case was a personal inspiration and help for many, many years, Billy Simons. And as I was going through our old footage, I caught him at the 91 Nats qualifying for top 20 day. And boy, he is somebody who has really paid back with helping Bobby Hunt, especially myself, other people. Always a sharing, giving person. This is a great memory flight of Billy Simons. He's living in Florida now, he's retired. And I wish someday he'd come back to the event. This was the last big plane I know Bill had made the shoestring. The 91 Nats top 20 day. Billy Simons flying for the last spot on our circle. Wind's been shifty, everybody's done. Billy has the last flight. And there's still one spot open. I don't know what score he needs, but try to get some of this flight if we can. We're not in good position here the way the wind is blowing. Bill will have the last official flight of this day. Everybody's done. The circle winners have been determined. This is just for the fifth place in the circle. think it's boiled down to either Billy or Bob McDonald or one of the Japanese fellas. And they haven't posted the score yet, so of course he's going to want to make this a good flight. Tomorrow for top 20 day. They cut the field to 20. They're going to take 8 advanced flyers, move on to the next cut. And the top 20 flyers will fly off to see who flies for the Walker Saturday. Gildini stopped by before. Had a nice conversation with him. He's looking real good. Saw Lou McFarland earlier in the week. Ed Southwick's recovering from a back operation, so what a nostalgic moments here. See the score. That's the last flight of the day. Signing off Thursday. Billy Simons, boy. Bill, we miss you. Build a plane. Come on back. Come up to Brodex. Come up to the Nats. Now, as I'm taking the tape off of this, there's little spots, and I ding this up once here, but The point I wanted to make is it's an ongoing thing. Every time I take up the tape, I look for any little spots need to be touched up. If there's any overspray, you can take it off with Gorham's and a little Q-tip or whatever. So far, we've been pretty lucky. I like the way the landing light looks, by the way. But I did the fuselage, and I want to backmask the canopy now and move that tape up just a 1/64 of an inch so that I can respray around the canopy edges. Because what happens if I don't do that every two or three coats of paint, I get a edge there, and I don't want to feel that edge. I want that to be perfectly smooth in the very end. This is a part of it that it's just ongoing. This constant touching up is an ongoing thing. The cowl, the flaps have all dried up pretty well, but there's always spots to be touched up and changed, and once I get the plane all put in one piece, I can get a better look at how everything locks together and how it looks. That from about this point in the job on, it just gets to be more and more fun. Even every step of taking this tape off, I'm being more and more careful, slow. When I get the last little bit off, then I'm going to card it, of course. Every single time you take tape off, you should card that edge. And what happens, it's funny, I talk about it, you wear out these plastic cards relatively quickly, but it's still a good way to get the edge off. Now I need to get that 1/64 tape off, the real thin tape. I can't even remember where I put the edge. Can't even find the edge, in fact. There it is. But if you see there's any chance at all that you're gonna pull any paint up, just use a little bit of heat. A little bit of heat from a hairdryer, and that's a John Brodak tip. Now see, this went right through the tip weight box, the trim. What I want to do, I don't want to paint it separately. I wanted to paint it so this would be a perfect match. Once I take this out, then I want to paint the edges with a brush. Otherwise, we're not going to have the edges painted as well as they should be. But the biggest trick to all this is that carding. Because if you don't get the edges down flat and even, and if you have to, you touch it up with a brush if you take a little too much. Now see the way these little edges come up? Let me get this up close. This is the kind of stuff a lot of people excuse moving the camera here, but let me see if I can get this up close. Because when you're doing more and more paint, thicker and thicker layers, what happens? You get these edges like this. And now the edge of the card at a 45 degree angle. You see the little hairs coming up even? And that's what gives you that nice crisp edge. 45 degree angle, and you just shave it. Every step of the way, every time you put tape on and take the tape off, card it. And we're carding it from the low side to the high side. You always work toward the newer paint. I always like to paint these little edges because if you don't get this painted, and you kind of can look down in there, and it just doesn't give you the good presentation that I think having these edges painted does. Just another little touch that I like to have. And I'll paint the yellow stripe down next time I go to do touch-up on yellow. But it's an ongoing thing, and it never ends. Right up to the point that the paint, even after it's buffed out, if you buff through some spots, it's always the edges that you buff through on. So having a little extra paint up here really does help. Now, step one, we're going to try to assemble a wing and a fuselage in Mike's body while our paint is drying here. And of course, there's a lot of little spots on there. Get them all off. We want to start with a perfectly flat, perfectly level table as step one. Any alignment thing that you do, you want to get that table as clean as possible. You put the alcohol on there ready?
Yes.
Okay, clean it up, baby. The first step is Mike's got the fuselage. So we're going to put a couple of dots of CA, just enough, and don't put any under the wing.
No.
Just enough to hold it. You see our glass table has some etched straight lines. So you can use one of the straight lines if you want as a reference, even though we have this pretty straight. Small amount. Don't glue it like it's a permanent joint. Just tack it. That end of the table is straight. We've already checked it, and Once we have a couple of dots in here, this holds this whole thing in position while we make the cutout for the wing. And then we want to reference the wing as straight. We have a center line on the fuselage we're going to work off. Now this is the way we traditionally put wood planes that are not take apart planes together. We've done this several times and it works pretty well, except when Mike does it.
When you put too many dots.
Don't put too many or you'll be sorry. Everything here is drying up the next couple of days while we work on Mike's plane. Get this in one piece. Get ready for the final sand out. We're going into spring production here on planes. The cut line, just go 1/16 of an inch further back. Otherwise, that gets difficult to put that piece in.
How's that?
Okay, give it a little reference line. Use a 45-degree triangle. Same thing up in the front. And these lines are not critical. It doesn't matter. We're going to sandwich this back. But when we cut this, we're going to cut it on an angle like you would cut a piece of bologna, piece of salami. To cut it like a bologna slice. And the ones up in the front are difficult because there's plywood there. Just go slow. All our blades are razor sharp. They have been since the Stone Ages.
This one comes from tradition.
Yeah, this has probably got traditions wood. I'll try to buff this up for you. Okay. It is a real good idea to get these angles all, because the angle gives you more of a footprint to get the, when you make the joint. And when you do two zona cuts, you're removing about a 1/32 of an inch of wood, and we can make up for that with a piece of 1/32 plywood or balsa. That cut gives a lot of glue angle, a lot of glue surface. Okay, same thing. Now all you have to do is do it again, and the back ones, the balsa woods, jump right out at you. You got the piece out there. Now we want to get the wing and just see which side needs to be dressed off. Let's do a rough, let's get a rough shot on that and see which side has to be drafted. Just get that dressed off and let's see how the wing is going to drop in there. We dropped it in. Mike's picked up the high spot. It's on, there's a little high spot on his side. So just take the wing out, or you can get it, can you get in there and
guess I'm gonna get a little more here.
You don't want to take off more than you have to. Just take enough.
There.
See where it's resting. There. You can look under there. Even though the center lines are pretty good, but we're resting up on a little high spot.
Okay.
Okay, just take the wing out and just dress off that little. How far is it? It's usually right where the plywood is.
Yeah. It goes from this mark right to
the. Okay,
right,
I can feel it. Right. I can feel it, yeah. Now just take a little bit off at a time until we get all those center lines to line up. Take a little bit at a time. Yeah, this side's perfect. Take a little bit at a time. Don't make yourself, you know, don't take and make a big hole there. After many hours of careful sanding. Okay, you got the line. Now what we're doing, we're lining up the center line on this with the center of the 1/8-inch horn. And it looks like he's got that one bullseyed right in. And in the front, we want all the center lines. See, this is a quick way to do it because nothing else matters if these things aren't on center. You've got all four of them now.
No, not yet.
What do you mean, no?
Not yet.
Okay, keep at it. It's got it. That's got to be. No, look at this. That's going on the floor.
I won't let it.
Okay, but even a little bit. Get it as accurate as you can because that's just less glue and glop you have to put in there. And you're going to have an aeropoxy light fillet on there, so it doesn't even matter. After many hours, he says, he swears, this is
right
perfectly
on
right on me. Okay. Now, next thing is we want the same amount sticking out on both sides so that this is in the center. So we've marked that with a piece of tape. So when we go to put the epoxy on there, and we're going to put slow drying epoxy. Also, now you got to make a gauge for the front, get a piece of scrap balsa and make like a triangle so that both angles are the same. Otherwise, the wing is not going to be straight on the body. So we have this as a reference. First thing is the lines. Second is the horn. Third is, now we're actually pivoting on this until we get the wing straight. Or if you're wrong, if you really Don't have it right. Let the body be offset a half a degree, but never have the body coming in at you. That is the one situation. Don't let it be coming in at you. Pick up a little piece of scrap balsa, which of course you can use over and over, and see that the angle on both sides is the same. And if it isn't, of course, we're pivoting here and just getting our fine-tuning that angle. And if you're not sure it's right, let the fuselage point out a half a degree. Okay, so now we know we have the center line, center in the back, center in the front. Mix the glue.
Mix it up. I think it's
using a slow drying epoxy where one tube is SIG epoxy, one tube is twice the size. It gives us plenty of work time and plenty of time as that's in the cradle. Can fine tune it, check with our gauge, double check all the center lines. Gives you plenty. If you try to do it with 5 minute glue, I don't know. Good luck. You better have it right the first time. Okay, you got plenty of glue in. Now the idea is to drop this in one shot so you don't smear that glue all over the place. No, you don't have to. And he's ready. You just want to try to drop it in on the first shot. So it's easy. You line up.
Shall I put it in an upside down?
Jack will
like
that.
Here, Rich, this is for you.
Yeah. You got marks on the front of the wing. Where they go? The little black ink lines? Okay. Try to just whittle that in. It's a highly skilled technician. Now you got the green things in the back. Okay, you're lined. Now, you got the lines up in the front. Now slide it. First thing, check that you got all four of the center lines lined up. Put something heavy up there, a couple of cans of Brodak.
Go outside and get a brick.
Yeah, a truck tire. Get a couple of cans of Brodak dope and lay them down. Don't stand them up. That's good. Just put it up there. Doesn't matter what color it is. Doesn't matter.
Yeah, well, silver goes with silver.
Okay. Yeah, okay. I knew. You're such a designer. Okay, but now start eyeballing up all your center lines. Make sure all those center lines are right on the money. You got all the center lines lined up?
Yes, sir.
Check with your little gauge. Double check. Okay, now you just gotta babysit it. You got about an hour. You can check it every 15 minutes or so before that kicks off. Make sure that isn't putting a dent in the wing. Okay. First part of the job done in the bank.
In the bank.
Mike's wing is drying in step one. And by the way, this is what we did. Put a little piece of tape because how many times we walk by and the whole thing flies off the table. Anyway, I had put a dent in this the other day that I fixed. And I just wanted to, while we're waiting for things to dry, wanted to back mask that. Just hit that with the airbrush. Now here's the thing where the airbrush is really handy because you're only going to get paint in a very tiny area. Another thing, I had back masked the canopy and I was not happy the way the paint edge was. It even was getting a little thick even after moving it a few times. So I moved it a significant amount, and I'm just going to blend in the canopy again. I wanted the whole canopy to be the dark color too. Really one area where the airbrush really comes into its own, because we can really, as I said before, we can hold it with both hands. I have that taped off down there. And you don't get a lot of overspray. You don't have to back mask the whole plane either. For some real nice repair work, very, very convenient. The airbrush has proven to be very good in this kind of a touch-up operation. Moving those edges back little by little by little, it really, really makes that transition a lot nicer. Anyway, she's drying up. Mike's stuff's babysitting. We're going to have the big lunch. Big lunch on Mike's credit card. Time to put the little pieces back in. The epoxy's dried up. Now normally, what you want to do, Mike, is get this glue joint made. most important thing that you get a piece of 16th plywood, maybe at least an inch wide, doubling that. Then when you come back here, you're going to be short by a 32nd of an inch. Right. Because you've taken two saw cuts. Then just put a piece right in there. And if you need to dress it off, see, that looks like you need to dress off a high spot.
Yeah, right in there.
There's a high spot right up in there. Okay. And we got the James back here. To, how many thousand horns are we making today?
A lot.
Wow. Brodeck says you don't work hard. Eat your heart out. Look at this. Putting the bushing press. Getting the bushings in. Oh, I'm telling you, I'm so happy. And I'm going to make some more pipes for Lyle Larson. But the main thing is we want to get this so we can get this off the table today by the time Mike leaves. Make a pattern for the doubler. He's going to make the little doubler. But I want to use multiples of 64th plywood with all the grain going front to back. Has these pre-glued with thin CA. You got them pre-glued already, Mike?
Right.
Okay, now we can just lay that right in position, get the inside, get this nice and even, and just hit that with thin CA for the time being. Make sure that's lined up. Make sure it's lined up. Tack it first. Make sure you get one drop on there. Once it's pre-glued, that'll be fine. Okay, he's making up out of balsa wood the back pieces. So when this is right, We've taken material out of here. We have to make a nice little shim that's going to take up, see the little gap in there? It's just, see how thick that is. It's less than a 16th and more than 32nd. So take a 16th and just sand it down a little bit. Okay, and you got the other one ready to go on? Okay. Okay, he's got his things tacked in place, getting ready to install a doubler here. And we'll be able to actually take it off the table tonight.
This is the way to do this when it's glued to the table.
Oh, yeah.
That's how you did it, glued to the table?
Oh, yeah.
He laughs, but it works.
Works great.
He laughs. Try doing that in your lap, puppy. Okay, all the doublers are in, and that's all Jimmy's going to get done today. Jimmy had to leave. Right. And we have to take care of our toon pipe production and our horn production and our... Okay. I don't know, I think he's bullshitting on the phone in there. Oh, look at that telephone, what a professional. Boy, I'll tell you, no matter what you pay Jimmy, it's not worth it. All right, we'll continue this episode tomorrow.
And he can talk while he works.
Now, it was a hectic day today. We got to make toon pipes, we got to make horns, we got to finish most of the paintwork on a Typhoon. And we got some great mail. This is David Chang. They've shown here with a Tom Morris Cavalier. And he's one of our newer subscribers. He is going to attempt to make, and I think this will really be awesome, and we'll help him in any way we can, a Cavalier carbon fiber fuselage for his next Cavalier. He sent a real nice note. He's got a really high level of craftsmanship, and I don't... David, to tell you the truth, after watching the videos, I don't think it's out of the range of even an average model, or let alone one with a high skill level. Give it your best shot, man. Let me know how I can help. We look forward to seeing it. Also, with Bill Rutherford working on that Bearcat project, oh, it's just going to be the best year ever. Okay, Mike doesn't want anybody to know, but last night... when we went to take the plane off the table, he really glued it to the table. He almost had to take the table and take it home with him. Anyway. Okay, you got that all ground out there, baby?
Yeah.
Now, that former that we use in the top, we're just going to leave about an eighth of an inch on each side as a reinforcement. You got the belt crank mount in there?
Yes.
No, oh, I'm so impressed. You are an impressive guy. Okay, you got the belt crank mount in. Flip it over so we can see the bottom. The wing is in level now. Now the next thing we need to do, get the push rod. Okay, you're all set, baby. We're gonna leave this go for right now because I still haven't decided what we want to do. But let's get the push rod in there, solder the push rod in place.
Okay.
And then we'll get the tail lined up, and then we have to line up all the things. Now because we have that flat Miss Ashley kind of tail, the lineup will be a snap. Do, we're gonna put the notch in a wire, solder this end. this end now, because this is our flat surface, this is going to be our flat surface, the tail will just drop down flat. We know we have that part of the alignment. Measure out the two hinge lines, hinge line to hinge line. Put a little slow drying epoxy on there and let it sit in place. And we pretty much can get this. That's the easy part here. It goes right on the top of the fuselage. You don't need to have that little kerf. And if you have a kit that has the hole in it, put a little scrap piece in there. A nice, really, really heavy duty bell crank support with this. Here's what we do. We put the little notches on both ends and a little eyelet, a reversed, so that the brass part is rubbing up on a horn. Do all the joints with Stay-Brite silver solder and deflux it with baking soda and water. The reason I say that over and over, if you don't deflux it with baking soda and water, you can do this too, Mike, to make it easy for yourself. Take it up like that. I teach everything my know to Mike, and it takes about 15 minutes a day. Now, we use nothing but tin foil under it because we've set planes on fire already doing it this way. Now this is the point in time if you're going to have slop in the controls, you want to have either end of this push rod with an 1/8 inch hole for the slop. The reason we have the wire and the little notches is a redundancy system. All of the push rod ends face outward as a redundancy system. Get a good joint there, baby?
Perfect.
Does Peeps approve? Oh, what? Oh, don't put
Peeps.
Peeps, get away from that soldering iron. Geez, you're going to ruin his whole day. That's not funny, Peeps.
You get pissed off, you peck at that.
Yeah. Known up until today what kind of bird Peeps is. This magazine came in the mail and has a story about Baltimore Orioles. And there's Peeps. I'm going to hang this up by his Raven sign. Look at this. Is this him? Peeps, when you were a kid, you were all ugly and brown. Now you're a beautiful bird. Well, you're better looking it. Look. Look at this.
That's me in a magazine. I'm famous. I want to go to Brodax. Get me a traveling cage.
Okay, it's the baking soda and water that neutralizes the acid, and that's a critical step anytime you use Stay-Brite. Now you also want to, we'll put some chain lube down on those controls, oil them up a little bit before we put these in position for good. What I like to lubricate the controls with, motorcycle chain lube. This stuff, it goes on like foam, but boy, you take a plane that's been in service for 10 years. You look at it and the chain lube is still in place. It doesn't blow away, it turns into wheel bearing grease. Any motorcycle place will have this. One can will last you more than even your whole lifetime. Anyway, it's turned into an airplane. A little shim in here. This locks the flaps in neutral. Mike can put the elevators in neutral now. And that, when you drop the pushrod down, it sets the tail in place and just rotate it until both hinge lines are even. This is where you really gain time with a flat Miss Ashley type of tail, or even any flat tail. Yep, this is in dead neutral now. And since we know the tail is 1/2 inch, we took a piece of 1/4 inch wood and just put some ink marker on the side so that I can go down here and I want the center of this to be right on the edge of that wood. Very easy, and it's not hard to see that we're right on there. Now Mike's looking from the front, make sure that's, if not, what do you see? This is the high side?
High side's high.
Okay, a lot of times you can just do this and that'll babysit. No?
Better.
Okay, take a couple of swipes of sandpaper on that side, because once we get that, then the last thing is hinge line to hinge line, glue it up. Actually, it's a fraction of the time it takes to do an airfoil tail. And alone, it's a big help to have a little block of wood, because you can just let it sit right there. And that holds everything up out of the way and makes you crazy because it keeps falling down on you. Mike, it doesn't take much to change that whole thing. Go one little step at a time and then try looking at it again. This is the alignment we're looking for, is to get this lined up here. Put that little can right in the middle. Okay, and just eyeball it. We'll get the front to back. That's not going to change as long as you have that edge. Because this you're going to babysit, you know, no matter what. This is the big babysit job. Close. Give it a little bit more, and then we just repeat the same thing over. Okay, after about 20 tries, you got that alignment good. Okay, Mike's gonna be babysitting it while I'm working on a tune pipe project.
Can we take that foam out?
Yeah. Let me show you the trick way of taking a foam out. Okay. Okay, now you also, if you want to do this, you can put a little... Oh, it's sitting flat, because the bottom of the body's flat, okay.
Okay, let me double check this one.
Double check it, you never can. And then he's using slow drying epoxy, so he'll have 45 minutes an hour to babysit this. And we did check the hinge lines, and they're perfect. Hinge line to hinge line, so I think he's just lucky. Do it with slow drying epoxy. What's nice is you have plenty of time. And boy, that hour that you babysit, it's money in the bank. You always want to check that everything's in neutral, hinge line to hinge line, and from the front of the plane, they're both parallel. As well as precision, Mike's got... I find it easier to use a piece of quarter inch, just easier to use than the big ruler. We put the mark on the ruler. Make sure you're holding that parallel to the fuselage. Don't have it off on a 30 degree angle, because you can still fine tune it if you have to. This dimension's good.
Very good. How does that look?
Pure perfect.
Okay.
And you've got, check that everything's in neutral. There's days when I used to do foam airfoil tails all day. You'd spend the whole day. And here it is, what is it? We've been doing this, it's 10 o'clock. Piece of cake. Okay, now the trick is the babysit job. You babysit it, I'm working on Lyle's tune pipe problem. Okay, what Mike's doing is putting in a little bit of a geodetic ladder across the top. That's just to make the fuselage a little bit stiffer. Mike's putting the internal fillets in. Let's say, put in some triangle stock, C8 it in. Now you can take the, try to hold the blade almost 90 degrees. Hold the blade 90 degrees. If you got too much of an angle, it just mushes it. Then you can get a little sanding block, you know, the little tadpole in there?
Yeah.
Last little bit with that piece here. Now you can sand that to a nice rate, almost like a fillet that would be on the outside of the plane. And you can get a real nice internal fillet top and bottom. Worked out. Now Mike, this was the original plan. We want to put a 5-ounce tank in here. So this is where a 4-ounce tank would end. So we cut a hole previously in the back of the bulkhead, and we notched out the front of the wing. Let me see it from the front too. Now let's see if we can slide this tank right in there. Put it down on a pad. Now you can go actually almost to the point, we could even put a 6-ounce tank in here. Perfect.
All right.
Okay, we want to go back about another half an inch so we have room for the former. And then we got to put the little special venting in the tanks. Okay, and that's going to get a former in there. And that allows you to put, you actually on this, you'll, what did we make the nose, 8 inches?
Yeah.
It's an 8-inch nose. You'll be able to definitely put a five, and at least a 5.5 and maybe a 6. The former in there. Now you can get a full 6-ounce tank into an 8-inch nose Cardinal kit. And that's what we were looking for. As we put some lightning holes into the formers. Again, remember this fuselage is wider than a normal Cardinal kit. Shorter nose, wider by just a bit. Now Mike's going to get in there and work on the top, the internal fillets. I want to start fitting up the nose. We have these balsa shells we're going to start fitting up. Just that whole top. Use the block the long way if you can. Because these balsa shells have a perfectly straight edge, so we hope we're going to be able to get them. Land. Gerald Champ used these on his ship, the same shells. Once you make the mold, you're done. For the rest of your life, you get free shells. Like owning a chicken, you get free eggs.
Free eggs? Oh no, don't say free eggs.
You're toast. You're toast. How come you're not helping? Some half moon wood added here, added a solid crutch just to lighten it up, because these motors don't vibrate anywhere near as much as the old Tiger 60s did. what we did at the back here. We ended, so there isn't going to be, you never want to have a stress riser where the mounts just end. You want to have it kind of taper in. The more of a taper and angle you can put on it, the better. Now, the reason we feel comfortable doing this is because this fuselage is wider. What we've gained, if you notice back here, it's wider all the way down. When it's wider, you can make a thinner shell. Well, because these shells were made for a 2 1/4 inch spinner, we just added some 16th pieces up in the front, and then we'll just trim them in. Now, the advantage of doing that over a block, if we put a little block up here, it'd be a joint, and you know that joint's going to show. So this gives us plenty of wood to work with, and now we can just tack glue this on, because we're not going to take it off, and in fact we can put a permanent glue joint and then taper that right into the spinner. What Mike is doing is, before we do any CA up around these blind nuts, we're taking some chain lube and making sure all the threads have chain lube in them. I don't want to have some thin CA drip down in there. You only have that happen once and you'll learn your lesson. Isn't that right?
Oh boy!
Is that the truth?
God.
Glue seam from both sides. Before we even sand it down, you can see how much has to be carved and sanded. And Mike's got to make a little former up for in there, for so that air can't get back into that. I don't want to have air filling up the fuselage or oil or whatever. That'll kind of seal the engine compartment. Okay, now that little former sealed up that, I can't even see it, sealed that area up well, and yet we still want to have that little air outlet on the top so we can prime the engine. All right, let's carve that top in.
Okay.
Next step, lay it up there, get carving, baby.
Carve away.
And this looks like the last we're going to get on this tape. We're coming up on the end of the tape. Mike's going to do a final sanding on that, and we want to get that, if we do have time on this tape or on the next one, that little prime hole. Always want to be able to prime a 4-cycle through the top if we have that option. Let's look at it from this angle here. Hold the spinner up. Let's see how it's looking with the spinner on it. Yeah, just eyeball it with the spinner on. Yeah, you still got to take just a little more off. Because when you with the last thing, you're going to put the motor in, put the cowl on, and a spinner, and then do the final little shaping right in, all in one spot. You're getting close. It's just gonna take time. Take your time. No rush. Take your time.
It's close.
As a sidebar to this, Mike is busy making up some stooges too.
But he's real slow.
All right, we're gonna take a piece of a cutoff end from when we make up carbon fiber tuned pipes, which of course we just happen to have plenty of tuned pipes here. Going wild with tuned pipes lately. I don't know why. We need to estimate where the intake is going to be, because we want to set this air duct right on top of the carburetor, but off to the middle. Don't want it asymmetrical. So first thing, put the engine in. Estimated where the intake is going to be, and just poke a hole in the top block. Okay. And we have a little piece of the end piece of a carbon fiber pipe. Okay, flip that over, and when we'll estimate where we want this to be. Now, it's off center. We're going to put this in the center, but it's big enough that you can drop a prime right in there. Cut it out undersize, and then we'll just get it so it's a relative. Yeah, that's good. It'll be a nice tight fit. And it's just a little fine tuning until we can get a nice press fit on that piece of carbon. Now, the thing that's nice about the carbon, inside it doesn't need to be sealed up grain. It's really a hard thing to get the inside of a wood cutout to look nice, but with the carbon, it's like a given. Okay, to leave it just a little bit up, and then Mike will block sand it right in, and we'll flip it over and put a glue joint on the inside, and that'll allow us to prime the engine and get some cooling air going through there. Nice blast of cooling air come out of there too. Okay, get an extra CA joint on that. Here we can just see that we didn't disturb that. Get that nose ring blended in. Next thing we're going to do is make that little piece that goes behind the cowling. Part of this piece is we have to put the angle back here. We could do that on a belt sander. Yeah, just get that belt sandered in, Mike. pick up the rest of this work on the next tape. We're going to get that piece in. But I hope you're getting some good ideas or some... Please share the ideas with us. Share the tape. Did you get it? Oh, okay. Now you got to just trim the bottom. Get an ink line on the bottom. Now this plane is going to have this piece and then drop down like a... Like, I guess, like a Geesky Noble. We want to have more side area up in the front. Of course, it's a shorter nose. We have to compensate for having less side area to keep the balance of a, what we know works pretty well. I think Mike's going to make some little adjustments to the cowl edges. We want to take this off and cut the hole for the air outlet and hollow it out. An air outlet hole that reflected the shape of the cockpit, the cowling. And Mike's going to cut this out, and we're just going to see how we like this. We got a terrible supervisor we have to deal with here at every cut of the material. Look, there we go. As he drops it on the floor.
Let's make another one.
Put that in place. Let's see if you like it.
I like it.
Okay, now we got to get the angles back so the air is going out and not in. Get this little piece ready to install, and I hardened up the edge with thin CA here. I want to get as much of the extra weight out of there as possible, of course. Sand the whole inside out too, sure. So how's it fit? Nice? Oh, you didn't have the cowling on it. Okay. When that piece and the cowling are on together, I think it's going to look nice.
Yeah, we could live with that.
You can live with it, huh? Hey, Mike's got the tailwheel in. He's rolling right along. And I told him an old trick is cut the tailwheel hole in the sheet and then trim the outside, because it's a lot easier to do that than to trim the hole and then find a tail. But he's going to prove me wrong. Why do I get a feeling I'm going to be proved wrong here? All right, let's see you get that on with no holes in the no joints.
No joints.
He's going to do it. He's a pro.
If you shut that camera off,
I'm... A little lip for this so that the two points join equally. He got the hole right on the first shot. I am so impressed. He's a lucky dog. Anyway, we're going to pick this up on the next tape. We are, I thought we'd get more than this done today, but unfortunately...
We are exhausted. You put some glue on here?
Sure. It's always easier to get the piece glued in, oversized, and trim it than try to make it the right size and then glue it and... Just a little bit easier this way. Trim that sucker away. By the time we work on this, we're going to do the top. Bottom's done. Boy, it's really starting to shape up. This guy's ready for ink. We may get some ink work done next week. We're trying to work on two projects at the same time and balance them. And a week from now, Midgley is going to be here with... the carbon wing plane to paint, so we're trying to get these two guys out of the way. Anyway, we'll see you on the next tape. We got a lot of exciting projects. More tune pipes coming up. More phone calls to answer. It just never ends here. Pretty good way to spend your life, believe me. Could be a lot worse.